Welcome to the complete story of Final Fantasy VII, the game that effectively put Final Fantasy on the map, and continues to be one of the most celebrated and recognizable entries in the series, more than two decades after the game's release. The game has since spawned a collection of supplementary materials, such as a host of other games, and a feature film computer-generated action extravaganza. Not to mention an ongoing remake series that hopes to reimagine the legacy of the game for a new age. The story of the game tells an intricate tale of the relationship between humanity and nature, a struggle with self-identity, and also their snowboarding, making for one hell of an adventure. But anyway, I'm Pétur from Birds of Play, and in this video, I hope you'll join me as we revisit the game that not only introduced me to the Final Fantasy series, but also introduced the world at large to the power of video game narratives. We've got a planet to save, and I hope you'll be with us every step of the way. A young girl, carrying a basket of flowers, walks onto the streets of Midgar, a dystopian metropolis where one can only imagine flowers would be hard to come by. The city is encircled by a collection of massive power plants that harvest Mako, the world's new premier source of energy, each reactor emitting an eerie green glow when active, and releasing tall pillars of fumes into the atmosphere. In another part of the city, a train turns into a station next to one of the reactors, and as soon as it stops, a ragtag group of eco-terrorists, calling themselves Avalanche, jumps off the train and knocks out the station guards. Finally, the newest addition to the group somersaults off the train and lands on the platform before following suit. As he catches up to Biggs, Wedge, and Jesse, the Avalanche members, he reluctantly introduces himself as Cloud Strife. While the others gush about him being an ex-soldier for the Shinra Electric Power Company, hired by them to help them take down the reactor. On the way to the reactor core, Barrett Wallace, the leader of the group, gives a rousing speech about how Shinra is killing the planet, but Cloud shows little interest in Avalanche's cause. Seeing as Cloud is a former employee of Shinra, Barrett decides to keep a close eye on him. As Cloud prepares to set the bomb, he hears a voice in his head telling him to watch out and that this isn't just a reactor. Cloud, nevertheless, follows through, prompting the group to escape the reactor before it blows sky high. After emerging from the rubble, Barrett orders everyone to split up and rendezvous at the Sector 8 train station. As ordered, Cloud goes his own separate way, where he runs into the flower girl, who sells him a flower before continuing on her way. On the way to the station, Cloud is ambushed by a group of Shinra soldiers, forcing him to jump onto the train and swing into the train car, where the rest of the gang is already assembled. On the way to Sector 7, Jesse shows Cloud a map of Midgar on a monitor inside the train and tells him about the security checks conducted as the train passes through certain checkpoints. Afterwards, Cloud and Barrett have a short heart-to-heart, wherein Cloud acknowledges the plight of the people of the slums, who live underneath the upper plate that blocks the sun like a giant pizza in the sky, saying they are just like the train, and they can't run anywhere except where the rails take them. As they arrive back in Sector 7, Barrett gives the order to meet up back at the hideout. The hideout is situated in a secret cellar underneath a bar called Seventh Heaven that is run by Cloud's childhood friend, Tifa. Upon his return, Tifa welcomes Cloud back and offers him a drink before he goes to talk to Barrett about his payment. Cloud and Barrett argue, but as Cloud attempts to leave, Tifa stops him and tells him she wants him to join them. Cloud refuses, prompting Tifa to remind of a promise he made to protect her back when the two of them lived together in the town of Nibelheim. Cloud accepts to go on another mission for Avalanche, but while riding the train, their fake IDs get flagged by the security system, forcing them to jump out of the train at full speed. They make their way to the core of the next reactor, but as they make their escape, Cloud, Barrett, and Tifa are ambushed by President Shinra, the head of the Shinra Electric Power Company, who recognizes Cloud's Mako-infused eyes. President Shinra then introduces them to Airbuster, a techno soldier created by the Weapons Development Department at Shinra. The three of them manage to destroy the machine, but as the Airbuster explodes, Cloud is left hanging for dear life, before losing his grip and plummeting down to the ground far, far below. Upon awakening, Cloud finds himself lying in a bed of flowers, having somehow miraculously survived the fall. He is once again greeted by the flower girl, who tells him he is in a church in Sector 5. She introduces herself as Aerith, and the two of them start up a conversation. Before long, Reno, a red-haired member of the Turks, a special Shinra task force, enters the church, and upon seeing him, Aerith asks Cloud whether he has ever served as a bodyguard. Cloud seems to think he's up to the task, so Aerith asks him to take her home, offering one date as payment. The two of them make their escape through a back room and exit through a hole in the roof of the church. Cloud takes Aerith back safely to her house, where her adoptive mother, Elmira, awaits. Elmira is thankful to Cloud for bringing her daughter back safely, but she nevertheless asks him to leave in the middle of the night without saying anything to Aerith. Cloud respects Elmira's wishes and sneaks off the first chance he gets. Much to his surprise, however, Aerith is waiting for him as he attempts to cross through Sector 6 into Sector 7 and demands to tag along. On the way, the two of them take a break at a rundown playground, where Aerith tells Cloud about her first love, who is a guy from Soldier, just like Cloud. As they reminisce, a chocobo carriage emerges from Sector 7, carrying Tifa in the back. Cloud calls out to her, but to no avail. Upon seeing this, Aerith goes running after the carriage, leading the two of them to War Market, a seedy entertainment quarter and shopping district located in Sector 6. After asking around, they find out Tifa has been taken to Don Cornillo's mansion, but they can't enter the mansion because the Don is only interested in women. In order to meet the requirements, Aerith suggests Cloud dresses up as a girl to infiltrate the mansion, and after scouring War Market for a dress and the proper accessories, Cloud and Aerith return to the mansion as two prospective brides for Don Cornillo. Cloud is reunited with Tifa in the basement of the mansion, but she doesn't recognize him at first due to how he's dressed. After undergoing an evaluation by Don Cornillo, the three of them corner the crime lord in his room and force him to spill classified information. After threatening to dismantle his man bits, Don Cornillo cracks and tells them Shinra is planning to drop the plate above Sector 7, crushing Avalanche in the process. Before they can warn everyone, however, Don Cornillo activates a trap door and drops them into the sewers below. When they finally make their way back, the battle for Sector 7 is already underway, as Avalanche goes head-to-head with Shinra forces in a battle for the support pillar that holds the upper plate in place. Biggs, Wedge, and Jesse give it their all, but to no avail. And even though Cloud and Tifa rush in to support their efforts, Reno from the Turks still manages to activate the release system for the pillar. Zeng, the leader of the Turks, arrives in a helicopter, holding Aerith prisoner. Aerith having agreed to go with him in return for the safety of Marlene, Barrett's adopted daughter, whom Aerith had gone to rescue from Sector 7. Zeng makes off with Aerith, leaving the others to their doom. However, just in the nick of time, Cloud, Barrett, and Tifa manage to ride down a zipline and narrowly escape the ensuing explosion. But the rest of the people in Sector 7, including Biggs, Wedge, and Jesse, end up getting crushed by the upper plate crashing down on them. Having suffered a heavy blow, the three of them go to Aerith's house to find Marlene. After making sure she's alright, Barrett leaves her in Elmira's care, since the road ahead will be fraught with danger. Cloud vows to rescue Aerith from the clutches of Shinra, and Barrett is eager to come along so he can repay his debt to her for saving his daughter. The party infiltrates the Shinra building, the towers over Midgar from the center of the upper plate. While in the building, they eavesdrop on a meeting between President Shinra and the heads of the different departments. Shinra's management is concerned with the limited repositories of Mako energy available for harvesting, and fascinated with the legend of the Promised Land, a place of legend where Mako flows abundantly. Only a race called the Setra, also known as the Ancients, are, according to legend, able to find it. At the meeting, Hojo, the head of the company's science research division, talks about the need to breed Aerith as the last survivor of the Setra in order to secure her bloodline for future study. As the party pursues Hojo after the meeting, Cloud recognizes a headless creature called Genova that is being kept in a tank, the mere sight of it making him lose his bearings for a bit. After coming back to his senses, Cloud and the others confront Hojo as he attempts to breed Aerith with the beast and free her along with the strange creature. Much to their surprise, the beast can talk and tells them they can call him Red 13. Even though it is just a number assigned to him by Hojo. The newfound freedom of the captives doesn't last long, however, as the entire group ends up being captured and thrown into detainment cells. With no way to escape, Cloud is surprised to wake up to an open door. And as he exits the room to investigate, he stumbles upon the guard having been mysteriously murdered. Upon investigating further, they discover that the tank which housed Genova is empty, and as they follow the trail of blood, they reach the top floor of the building. There, President Shinra lies dead, with a giant sword in his back. A sword that could only have been wielded by the legendary soldier Sephiroth, a man Cloud appears to have some sort of past with. Barrett celebrates the death of the president, but the celebration proves to be a bit premature, as President Shinra's son, Rufus, shows up on the scene. Having heard of his father's demise, Rufus tells them he will control the world not with money like his father, but with fear. Cloud battles Rufus as the others make their escape, and after Rufus takes his leave, Cloud accompanies the rest of the party, riding a motorcycle, protecting them from the Shinra armed forces as they make a run for it in a pickup truck. Reaching the end of the highway, the party makes up its mind to leave Midgar, Cloud wanting to settle the score with Sephiroth. After leaving Midgar, Cloud is made the party leader, and they set their sights on the nearby town of Calm. In Calm, Cloud tells the party about his history with Sephiroth. Cloud tells them that 5 years ago, he and Sephiroth were sent on a mission to Nibelheim to investigate the Mako reactor at Mount Nibel, where he was reunited with Tifa, who acted as their guide. While investigating the reactor, Sephiroth began to unravel the mysteries of his birth and his relation to the entity known as Genova, Genova being the name of his mother. Troubled by his discovery, Sephiroth took refuge in the basement of the Shinra mansion, where his studies led him to believe that he, along with Genova, were descendants of the ancients, and that humanity had stolen the planet from them. As part of his revenge against humanity, Sephiroth then burned the town of Nibelheim down to the ground, killing Cloud's mother and Tifa's father, along with a large chunk of the townspeople, before going to see Genova, who had been stashed away in the reactor. Just before Cloud arrived on the scene, Tifa confronted Sephiroth at the reactor, but he cut her down, inflicting upon her a grievous wound. Enraged by Sephiroth's actions, Cloud followed Sephiroth into the back room, where Genova resided, and challenged him. However, Cloud's recollection fails him in the telling of the tale just as he confronted Sephiroth, making him unable to finish the story of their encounter. After resting up at the inn, the party heads for Junon in pursuit of a man in a black cape, matching Sephiroth's description. Along the way, they come across a monument to Sephiroth's power, as he has, presumably, impaled the head of a gigantic Midgar Solom, a species of giant serpents, at the top of a massive wooden spike. They also encounter a young ninja girl in a forest, and after beating her in battle, she agrees to join their ranks, introducing herself as Yuffie. As they arrive in Junon, they meet a girl named Priscilla, who's playing with a dolphin down by the ocean. But as a monster attacks the beach, Priscilla is caught underwater as she attempts to rescue her oceanic friend. After taking care of the monster, Cloud resuscitates Priscilla using CPR, and in return she helps Cloud reach the upper levels of Junon by letting her dolphin friend give him a boost. At the upper levels, Shinra soldiers prepare to welcome Rufus Shinra to Junon with a big parade, and Cloud disguises himself as one of the soldiers in order to get around. After playing his part, Cloud sneaks onto a cargo ship bound for the western continent and is reunited with the rest of the party aboard, who disguise themselves as crew members. During the voyage across the sea, members of the crew are mysteriously killed, and as Cloud and the others go to investigate, they find Sephiroth, who strangely doesn't recognize Cloud. Cloud demands to know what Sephiroth is up to, but he escapes, leaving behind a piece of Genova, which the party is forced to fight. Once the battle is over, the cargo ship arrives safely in Costa del Sol, a coastal resort town. From there, Cloud and the others continue to chase rumors of the man in the black cape, which leads them to the desolate town of North Corral. The townspeople there blame Barrett for the sorry state of North Corral, but all Barrett can do is say he's sorry. Later, Barrett explains that Coral used to be his hometown, whose main industry was coal mining. But then Shinra came along, making promises about how Mako Energy could make the town prosper. Barrett believed Shinra could make life better, but his friend Dine refused to accept their proposal. Ultimately, Barrett's side won, leading to the construction of a new Mako reactor. Once Shinra had gotten its way, however, Shinra troops burned Corral to the ground in retaliation for an accident at the reactor, which they blamed on a rebel faction, leading to the death of Barrett's wife and many others. From North Corral, the party rides a ropeway up to the Gold Saucer, a gigantic amusement park built over the ruins of Old Corral. There they meet Kate Sith, a fortune-telling cat robot who insists on tagging along with them. As they explore the park, they stumble onto a gruesome scene, as everyone in the battle square has been mysteriously shot to death, one of the victims using his last breath to describe the perpetrator as a man with a gun on his arm. Dio, the owner of the gold saucer, finds Cloud and the others on the scene and has them thrown down into Corel Prison, a prison facility in the middle of the desert. There, they are reunited with Barrett, who tells them he's looking for his long-lost friend, Dine, who he had presumed dead after they were attacked by Shinra when the company burned down Corel. Barrett and Dine were both shot in the arm, resulting in them getting grafted with guns. Barrett confronts Dine, but Dine doesn't want to listen due to his hatred for the world. The two of them fight, but even after Barrett has beaten some sense into him, Dine decides he can't go back and throws himself off a cliff. With Dine's reign of terror over, the prison manager permits Cloud and the others to win back their freedom in a chocobo race at the Gold Saucer. And once they have claimed victory, they continue on their journey. This time riding a small buggy, given to them by Dio as a way of apology for throwing them in prison. As they follow Sephiroth's trail, the buggy breaks down just outside Cosmo Canyon, a center for study of the planet and its life stream. Upon entering the settlement, it is revealed that Cosmo Canyon is Red 13's home, and that his real name is Nanaki. Having made his return, Red 13 intends to remain behind as the protector of Cosmo Canyon. But before parting ways, he introduces Cloud and the others to his grandfather, Bugenhagen, who teaches them about the life stream by inviting them into his planetarium. Bugenhagen tells them the planet is dying, since the life stream is gradually being sieved away in order to be consumed as Mako energy. Sitting around a campfire later that night, Red 13 tells Cloud he must remain behind to make up for his father's shame, his father having fled when the Gi tribe attacked, leaving Red 13's mother to die. Upon hearing this, Bugenhagen asks Cloud and Red 13 to accompany him to the cave of the Gi, where Red 13 learns the truth about his father, Seto, who didn't actually flee, but rather stayed to fight the Gi, eventually being turned to stone by their poisonous arrows, his petrified body still serving as a warning to any who might wish Cosmo Canyon harm. Bugenhagen tells Red 13 to go with the others, so that he might aid them in saving the planet. And as Red 13 vows to do all he can, the statue of Seto sheds tears of pride. As the buggy is fixed, the party keeps pursuing rumors of a man in a black cape and arrives at Nibelheim, only to find it fully rebuilt, as if the town had never been razed to the ground. The town is infested with people robed in black, who rant on about Sephiroth. And as the party searches for him at the Shinra Manor, Cloud finds him downstairs in the library. He asks Cloud to join him for the reunion, but Cloud doesn't know what he is talking about. Sephiroth escapes, but the party discovers that the cellar still has more secrets to tell, as they come upon a mysterious man resting in a coffin. Upon sharing their tale, the man is triggered by the mention of Sephiroth and wishes to hear more. He explains that he is a former Turk and introduces himself as Vincent. Vincent has been sleeping beneath the Shinra mansion in Nibelheim in penance for his sins of failing to stop the Genova project, but joins the party upon learning they might run into Professor Hojo, whom he deems culpable for everything. The group chases Sephiroth across Mount Nibble to Rocket Town, where they meet Sid Highwind, an aeronautical engineer whose dreams of going into space have been dashed by Shinra's lack of funding. The rocket, standing in the middle of the town, is a remnant of Sid's failed attempt at space travel, since he had to abort the launch due to Shira, a scientist working on the rocket, still being inside performing final checks during the launch sequence. not wanting to kill She-Ra, Sid aborted the launch, and She-Ra has taken the blame for destroying his dreams ever since. Soon after the party arrives in Rocket Town, Rufus turns up to confiscate Sid's airplane, the tiny Bronco, which Sid vehemently protests. As the party stops Palmer, a Shinra executive, from stealing the plane, they end up boarding it themselves along with Sid. The tiny Bronco crashes into the ocean after being fired upon. But even though it is no longer fit for flying, the party is able to continue using it as a boat. Not being free to return home, Sid joins the party. And as they continue to pursue Sephiroth, they start to uncover his plan. They learn that Sephiroth means to obtain the Black Materia, a materia so powerful that Cetra hid it away deep inside the Temple of the Ancients. In order to enter the temple, the party acquires the Keystone from Deal at the Gold Saucer. But before they can head out, the stone is stolen by none other than Cade Sith, who reveals himself to be a spy for Shinra. Even though he just betrayed them, Cade Sith insists on tagging along and threatens them with Marlene's voice, forcing them to do as he wishes, if they wish to keep the hostage safe. Riding the tiny Bronco to the Temple of the Ancients, the party encounters Tseng of the Turks, gravely wounded by Sephiroth. Tseng hands Cloud the Keystone, and with it, they are able to enter the temple. Inside, they discover that the temple itself is the Black Materia, and that Sephiroth intends to use it to cast Meteor, thereby summoning a meteorite to crash into the planet. Sephiroth's plan is to create a wound in the planet so large, a live stream will be sent on Mars to heal it, giving Sephiroth the opportunity to intercept it and take control of it. In order to safeguard the Black Materia, Cloud and the others decide to shrink the temple using its ancient mechanisms. The catch, however, is that someone must remain inside to operate it. Cade Sith volunteers, since his body is that of a robot. And as the temple turns into a materia of manageable size, his body is destroyed. Cloud takes the Black Materia, but Sephiroth appears and bends Cloud to his will. Subsequently, Cloud hands the Black Materia over to Sephiroth and attacks Aerith. Another Cade Sith appears to replace the one lost inside the temple, and the party knocks out Cloud to save Aerith. With Cloud still unconscious, Aerith leaves the party to find a way to save the world from Meteor, now that Sephiroth has acquired the Black Materia, traveling by herself to the Forgotten City, the lost city of the Cetra. As Cloud awakens, he is deeply troubled. Sephiroth was able to control him, but resolves to nevertheless continue his journey, as Tifa and Barret encourage him to go on. The party chases after Aerith and Sephiroth, when they finally find Aerith praying at an altar at the Forgotten City. Cloud is once again enthralled by Sephiroth and almost made to kill her. His comrades' voices helping him regain his senses at the last minute, before he swings his sword. With Cloud unwilling to finish the job, Sephiroth descends from up above, piercing Aerith with his blade, thus killing her. Cloud becomes justly enraged, but Sephiroth simply taunts him, telling him he should not act as though he has feelings. Floating up into the sky, the Sephiroth they had been hunting turns out to be a piece of Genova, which they are forced to do battle with, even as they grieve the loss of their friend. After the battle with Genova, the members of the party pay their respects to the departed Aerith, and Cloud lays her deceased body to rest in the waters of the Forgotten City. Cloud decides to continue his journey, to complete his revenge against Sephiroth, even knowing he may lose control of himself again. Journeying to the north, the party arrives in the small town of Icicle Inn, where they discover recordings that detail Aerith's birth and Genova's true nature, as that is where Aerith was born to Professor Gust and her mother, Ifalna. Gust was the scientist who led Shinra's Genova project before departing the company upon finding a true Setra, Ifalna, the last survivor. Gust helped Ifalna escape Shinra, and the two settled in the remote Icicle Inn, where Gust interviewed her on her knowledge on Genova and the guardians of the planet, weapons. Ifalna told Gust that Genova, which Gust had mistaken as a Setra, was in fact the calamity from the skies, responsible for Setra's dwindled numbers. Genova is a shape-shifting extraterrestrial organism that had arrived on a meteorite 2,000 years ago, creating the large crater at the planet's north pole. The creature was sealed away by the last surviving Setra, and it was from this geological stratum that Gust and his researchers excavated its body 2,000 years later. When Hojo discovered Gust and Ifalna's hideout, he killed Gust and took Ifalna and baby Aerith captive. The two later escaped into the Midgast slums, but Ifalna perished during the escape, leading Aerith to be adopted by Almira Gainsborough. The party follows Sephiroth to the North Crater that had been created by Genova's fall 2,000 years ago, a place overflowing with the lifestream as the planet continues to attempt to heal itself. They are joined by Rufus and his gang, arriving on the airship Highwind, believing the North Crater to be the promised land Shinra has been seeking. Down on the ground, Cloud and the party encounter a horde of Sephiroth clones, and as they catch up to Sephiroth, they see him throwing the clones down into the livestream below. Once again, Sephiroth proves to be naught but a piece of Genova, and after defeating Genova in battle, the party reclaims the black materia. Cloud explains to the others that what they have been pursuing is not the true Sephiroth, but that the real Sephiroth is now nearby. Cloud and Tifa go alone, and Cloud hands the black materia to a party member remaining behind to prevent himself from being tricked into giving it to Sephiroth again. Cloud and Tifa stumble upon an illusion of the events that took place in Nibelheim 5 years ago, and Sephiroth shows them that Cloud was in fact never really there. Contrary to Cloud's story earlier on, his role instead being occupied by a man called Sack. Tifa cannot refute Sephiroth's claims, and Cloud begins to believe they are true. Sephiroth claims Cloud is but a facsimile, created by Hojo, a puppet with false memories, posing as the boy Cloud, who Tifa knows from her childhood. Sephiroth creates another illusion to trick the party member holding the black materia to bring it to Cloud. Hojo, who has accompanied Rufus to the crater, is at first interested in Cloud, but upon discovering Cloud doesn't have a numbered tattoo, discards him as a failure. Annoyed, a failed experiment is the only one to have made it to the reunion with the true Sephiroth. Sephiroth's true body is inside a materia cocoon, and Cloud hands him the black materia, allowing him to summon Meteor, which in turn awakens the planet's guardians, the weapons, giant monsters of immense destructive power. As the crater floor crumbles, Cloud and Sephiroth's cocoon fall into the livestream, and the party escapes with Shinra on their airship. During their escape, Tifa is knocked unconscious by the shockwave from one of the weapons rushing out into the world. While unconscious, Tifa hallucinates, chasing Cloud, who disappears into darkness, and recalls how she met him at the Sector 7 slums train station some time before he was hired into Avalanche. Cloud was acting strange, and claimed it had been 5 years since they'd last seen each other. Although Tifa knew it to be longer than that, she had never confronted him, instead asking him to join Avalanche, so she would have more time to decide what to do, and to keep an eye on him and his strange behavior. Tifa awakens in Junon, 7 days later, to a world in chaos. A meteorite looms over the sky, a sign of the impending end of the world. Sephiroth has surrounded the North Crater with a barrier, preventing either Shinra or the weapons from attacking his true body. And the creatures have taken to attacking Shinra's site of power instead. Rufus, trying to show Shinra is still in control, decides to use Tifa and Barrett as scapegoats and publicly execute the pair on live broadcast television. Before the execution can go through, however, Sapphire Weapon attacks Junon, and Shinra kills it with a direct shot of the face with a Junon Mako cannon. The other party members, led by Kate Sith, sneak in during the attack to rescue Tifa and Barrett, and steal the Highwind for their own purposes. Being free to fly around the world, the party finds Cloud suffering from severe Mako poisoning in the town of Medeal, where he washed up by the currents of the livestream. Tifa stays behind to watch over him, as she is adamant Sephiroth's story of Cloud being Hojo's creation with false memories is untrue, and wants to help him regain his true self. The others return to the airship, and thanks to Kate Sith becoming a double agent, they are able to eavesdrop on a meeting at Shinra headquarters. Apparently, Shinra plans to collect huge materia, a highly condensed materia compressed and formed inside of Mako reactors, in the hope of launching them to stop the descent of Meteor, blowing the meteorite to bits. In the absence of Cloud and Tifa, Cid is elected as the new leader of the group, much to his surprise. And he makes it his first order of business for the group to get its hands on the huge materia, so that they can use them to continue the fight their way. After facing Shinra's down at Fort Condor and North Corral, the party returns to Medeal to check up on Cloud and Tifa. However, the town is suddenly attacked by the Ultima weapon, resulting in an enormous fissure opening up straight down into the livestream, swallowing up a large chunk of the town, and Cloud and Tifa along with it. Being submerged in the livestream allows Tifa to travel inside Cloud's subconscious and sort through his true memories and secret desires, such as joining Soldier, in part to gain Tifa's attention. She confirms Cloud is the genuine article, although not the person he made himself believe he was. In truth, Cloud never made it into Soldier, instead becoming a lowly Shinra infantryman. Embarrassed by his failure, he didn't tell anyone from his hometown. When he was assigned a mission in Nibelheim to accompany the Soldier members Sack and Sephiroth, Cloud concealed his identity by always wearing his helmet, and this is why Tifa didn't realize Cloud was there at the time. After Sephiroth learned Shinra created him from Genova, he went insane and torched the town. He then departed for the Mako reactor to save his mother, as Genova had been contained there. Sack confronted Sephiroth at the reactor, but lost. Soon after, Cloud arrived, seeking revenge, and a weakened Sack gave Cloud his Buster Sword to fight Sephiroth. After being impaled by the legendary Soldier, Cloud mustered the last of his strength and hurled Sephiroth into the livestream below the reactor. His life all but spent, Cloud then fell unconscious. After Hojo arrived to assess the situation, he took Sack and Cloud, as well as the other survivors from the village, to be his test subjects to turn them into Sephiroth clones by injecting them with Genova cells. While the villagers had been turned into clones, Sack and Cloud had not reacted as desired, and they were deemed failures to be contained in the Shinra manor. Cloud's mind was shattered by the trauma of the events as a result of Hojo's experimentation, and he ended up merging his ideal self with Sack and Tifa's memories, and replaced Sack with himself in his recollections. After Cloud had hurled Sephiroth into the Mako pit below the reactor, Sephiroth's body dissolved into the livestream. but his consciousness was strong enough to remain intact. Sephiroth thus learned the wisdom of the Cetra from the livestream, and began to construct a new body for himself inside a material cocoon at the North Crater. He mentally took over the remains of Genova at the Shinra headquarters, morphed it into his image, and used it to bring black materia to his true body to summon Meteor. As Cloud and Tifa are rescued from the livestream, the restored Cloud returns to lead the party, revealing to the others he was never in Soldier, as he wasn't deemed mentally strong enough to qualify. Upon hearing the party has been hunting for huge materia, Cloud joins the fray. Their hunt leads them to Rocket Town, where they storm the launch of the rocket ship, but end up getting trapped inside as it takes off. Cid discovers he was wrong for admonishing his assistant Shira for ruining his dreams of spaceflight, since there was in fact a part of the ship malfunctioning. As they return to the planet in an escape pod, Cid finally gets to live his dream of going into space. The rocket, however, fails to destroy the meteorite, meaning that the world still faces its imminent doom. With the help of Bugenhagen from Cosmo Canyon, the party discovers the reason Aerith had gone off alone to the Forgotten City. She had planned to summon Holy, the ultimate white magic, and a counter to Meteor, using the white materia that had been passed down in the Cetra lineage, and she possessed as the last Cetra. Just before her death, her prayer had reached the planet, allowing her to evoke the power of the planet. But Sephiroth is holding Holy back from within the planet's core. Before they can confront Sephiroth, they get news of Rufus, having moved the Juno Mako cannon from Junon to Midgar, in the hopes of firing upon the northern crater by using the Mako energy produced in the city, renaming the cannon Sister Ray. As they make their preparation, Diamond Weapon rises out of the sea and charges towards Midgar. The cannon destroys the weapon, and the blast reaches the North Crater, breaking Sephiroth's shield. Before dying, the weapon fires out energy blasts into the Shinra building, seemingly killing Rufus and creating a power vacuum at the top of the organization. Midgar falls into chaos, and Caith Sith pleads for Cloud and his friends to help, revealing his true identity as a puppet controlled by Reeve Twesty, a Shinra executive in charge of Midgar. Cloud's party infiltrates the city to fight Hojo, who has taken command of Sister Ray. Hojo is trying to relaunch it, even at the cost of obliterating Midgar. Cloud and his friends fight their way through the remaining forces of Shinra to reach Hojo, who reveals he wishes to give his son a boost from Sister Ray's power, thus unmasking himself as Sephiroth's biological father. Despite the power he has gained by injecting himself with Genova cells, however, Hojo is defeated and his plans thwarted. With only a week until Meteor Fall, Cloud asks everyone to come up with their own reason and resolve to keep on fighting, beyond the mere reason of fighting for the planet. Should they find one, they may return for the last battle. Cloud and Tifa have nowhere to go, and spend the night together under the stars. The next morning, the others return and Cloud thanks them for coming back, reminded of Aerith's hope and smile, even in the face of death. The party is driven to ensure her deeds aren't wasted. The party ventures deep into the depths of the northern cave and finds its way to the planet's core, where they finally confront Sephiroth, who is blocking Holy from being released. The team triumphs over Bizarro Sephiroth, and then Safer Sephiroth, a half-human, half-divine form befitting Sephiroth's dream of becoming a god. Despite Sephiroth's immense power, he is nevertheless defeated. As they attempt to return to the surface, Cloud collapses, his spirit torn from him for one last showdown with Sephiroth within the livestream. Unleashing all of his might, Cloud defeats Sephiroth, allowing himself to be free of him. As Cloud's spirit returns to his body, the cave around them starts to crumble, forcing them to make their escape. Despite their best efforts, their hard-earned victory comes too late. And when Holy is released, Meteor has fallen too far for Holy to unleash its full power. Midgar is laid to ruin in the struggle between Meteor and Holy, but Aerith's spirit commands the life stream to congregate and push Meteor far enough away from the planet for Holy to destroy it. 500 years later, Red 13 and two pups jump up to a precipice overlooking the overgrown ruins of Midgar, nature having reclaimed the land and turned the once bustling metropolis into a lush forest, teeming with life. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video, please subscribe and leave us a comment telling us, whether you liked it or whether you didn't, I don't know. As always, bird sounds.
Caw-caw!